There's nothing like walking through cool grass on a warm summer's day. But every Southerner knows that a barefoot stroll in the yard comes with risks.
This fire ant mound should be a familiar sight to anybody who lives in the southern US, but you won't see them marching around in little lines on the ground. We're surrounded by an underground network of foraging tunnels, but this is home base. And the best way to get to know what's inside is to give it a poke.
A fire ant's main senses are touch and smell. The slightest disturbance and workers release alarm pheromones, a chemical signal that can raise the entire mound to defense within seconds.
Anything sitting still is now a target, so let's get out of here.
A fire ant's bite isn't what hurts. Their mouths only serve as angers, so they can curl around a sharp stinger and inject a dose of venom, a painful reminder that they're in the same order of insects as bees and wasps, the Hymenoptera. Insect researcher Justin O. Schmidt developed a pain index for Hymenoptera venom, mostly by allowing himself to be stung over and over. The tiny sweat bee, for instance, is a 1, a tiny spark singeing a single hair. The bullet ant scores a 4, the most painful grade, like firewalking over flaming charcoal with a 3-inch rusty nail in your heel.
Fire ants only score a 1.2 on the Schmidt pain index, but they tend to sting multiple times, like this one did. It's already starting a local immune response around that venom. It's red, it's itchy, it's burning, it does not feel good. Within a few days, the cells will actually die and leave me with a nice little white bump that I will not be able to resist popping. The things I do for this show.
These stings have made fire ants the target of pure, unadulterated hate in the southern US. But it's important to remember that just like us, these ants are an imported species. The red imported fire ant arrived in the US between 1933 and 1942, accidentally scooped from their home in South America, placed on board a ship, and dropped in Mobile, Alabama. They left behind a hard life full of daily ant warfare, but in Alabama they found opportunity, few enemies, and a boy named Edward Wilson. E.O. Wilson would later become the world's leading expert in ant biology, but as a teenage scientist in Mobile, he recorded the first known sighting of imported fire ants. Over the next 2 decades, as Wilson and other scientists watched these ants spread out from Alabama, southern farmers went into full freakout. Now, maybe it was because the nation still had war on the mind, or the ants had red in their name, but the US stopped at nothing to eradicate them. Retired World War II bombers took to the air loaded with pesticide, indiscriminately showering the South with millions of tons of poison. We'd later learn that the pesticides used were many times more toxic than DDT. E.O. Wilson called the bombing campaign the Vietnam of entomology, and it was one of the inspirations for Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. In the end, aerial pesticides did do a lot of killing, but instead of fire ants, it was mostly to livestock, birds, fish, and native ant species. Nature hates a vacuum. By wiping out the native ants, we made it easier for imported fire ants to advance. They've since spread from Florida to Texas, onto California, even to Mexico, China, and Australia. Solenopsis invicta seems perfectly evolved for invasion. Part of the answer lies in how they reproduce. Hordes of winged males and future queens take to the air in massive mating flights. Pregnant queens then airdrop into new open territory free of competition, break off their wings, and bury themselves to give birth to new colonies. But in many places, like here in Texas, a genetic variation has made some fire ants lose their territorial nature. Many colonies here are home to many queens. They're more densely packed than their territorial relatives, allowing them to spread like a creeping fungus instead of airborne seeds. And thanks to their tropical origins, during floods, entire fire ant colonies can clump together and float until they find a new home. They invade by land, air, and water. It's no coincidence fire ants and humans are constantly running into each other. Fire ants crave disturbance, and humans provide that everywhere we go. Think of it this way. If you clear an area, take away the natural vegetation, the first thing to move back in are weeds. And so it is with fire ants. Tiny animal weeds. Like weeds, they're more annoying than dangerous, but imported fire ants cost $6 billion every year, damaging everything from golf courses to electrical equipment where they sometimes nest. Eradication is impossible, but the answer to controlling them might come from their South American home. Tiny buzzing insects, barely visible to the naked eye. Ant-decapitating flies. Forid flies, that's their technical name, are one of Invicta's natural enemies back home. They hover over unsuspecting workers, zip down, lay an egg inside the ant, and then fly away. That egg hatches, and a maggot crawls into the ant's head, eats everything inside, and eventually, the ant's head falls off. Scientists have imported these flies into the US so they can be used as a biological control method. One fly can terrorize hundreds of ants, putting a whole colony on the defensive. These flies are super specific to the species they attack, so scientists don't think they'll become a threat to native ants. But even if forid fly control works perfectly, imported fire ants will remain permanent residents. The name Invicta means unconquered, after all. Just like the people who accidentally brought them here, these ants found themselves in a strange land of opportunity, just trying to make the best of it. The bright side is that after decades of studying how to kill them, the fire ant now rivals the honeybee as the best understood of all social insects. And for all their stinging, they've taught us a ton about evolution, social behavior, and of course, parasites that make your head fall off. Carl von Frisch said something about those honeybees that I think applies equally well to fire ants. They are like a magic well. The more you draw from it, the more there is to draw. And who knows, each time we walk barefoot through their little world, maybe they've just been begging to be noticed. Stay curious. Nowhere is that more apparent than at a competitive gaming tournament. Hundreds of players from around the world competing for prizes up to $50,000. Watching the furious fingers of the world's top players flying to land combos and kills, the obvious question is, what makes them so good? What makes the experts better than the rest of us? The obvious answer is practice. But looking around a tournament like this, one can't help but notice, these players are young.